Hi, this is Lindsay Petras.
I'm Adam Sorma.
I'm Stephanie Bria.
Welcome to The Slaw.
Welcome to The Slaw.
The Slaw.
Very Local's podcast where we stay on top of all things Pittsburgh.
Each week, we highlight Pittsburgh places and Pittsburgh people.
We feature unique collaborations.
And even make some event recommendations.
The Slaw is all about the stories that make Pittsburgh, well, Pittsburgh.
Pittsburgh.
Are
the people ready for the groundhog to reveal his news? Do you want to hear what Phil says?
Welcome to The Slaw. I'm Stephanie, and we took an approximate two-hour road trip to Punxsutawney for today's episode. Joining me are two members of Punxsutawney's Groundhog Club, AJ DeRoom, who is one of Punxsutawney Phil's handlers and known by the moniker The Rainmaker, and Dave Gelati, whose official title is Thunder Conductor. Both are members of the Inner Circle, the group of top-headed men who managed the Groundhog Day festivities. All right, so in 60 seconds or less, what is Groundhog Day? If for someone out there who has no idea.
Groundhog Day to me is a joining together of like-minded people. And in saying that, I mean people that just love to enjoy life. I mean, it for them to take time out of their day and travel as far as they do and pay as much money as they do to stand in the middle of a woods in the middle of winter, waiting for a groundhog to predict the weather is nothing more to me than just the pure passion for life, for joining together with all those around them to pay homage to Punxsutawney Phil, you know, see if it's going to be six more weeks of winter and just enjoy themselves.
AJ.
Well, Groundhog Day to me is just a great holiday where you don't owe anybody anything other than a smile and a belief in something hopeful in the middle of the doldrums of winter.
And that something hopeful is spring coming early, right?
Unless you're a skier.
So really works both ways, regardless of what Punxsutawney Phil
That's right.
says.
Yeah, you're cheering for something. And if you're a naysayer, maybe you're cheering for someone to mess up. But, you know, Phil has been right 100% of the time. So we know that's never going to happen.
And so essentially it's a celebration and a groundhog makes a prediction on the weather from a very basic level. And it's either six more weeks of winter or not.
Correct.
Why do you think that this has been such an important part of our culture for so long? Do you think that people just like the idea of coming together?
I think it is. It was at first when there was smaller crowds, I think it was still something, you know, jestful that they could do and have a great time doing. Actually started out early days as the groundhog hunt, you know, so that
Which was still coming together.
It was still coming together. Mm-hmm. And as time went on, I mean, they put top hats on, they put tuxedos on. I mean, they're doing that as a prestigious fun. You know, it's all just about enjoying life and get really removing yourself from the day-to-day grind for a brief moment, putting on a funny hat, getting together with a bunch of people that just enjoy doing the same thing. I mean, there's never fights in the crowd of thousands that are cold and, you know, bound together, you know, it's close quarters. But there's never instances where there's even anything of that would resemble that because everybody kind of has the same tone, you know, they're just enjoying it.
And where does this take place? So obviously we're in Punxsutawney.
We are in Punxsutawney. You're at the epicenter of Groundhog Day right now.
We are actually, guys, it was a very dramatic entrance.
That's right. There was fanfare, horns, you know, all kinds of stuff, but yeah, no, we are at Gobbler's Knob. You're actually in you're in the kitchen of our visitor center.
Yes, we're recording this in the kitchen.
There was a little bit of construction going on, so this seemed to be the quietest place. But Groundhog Day in Punxsutawney happens on Gobbler's Knob, which is a little kind of natural amphitheater on the outside of town. Most people that haven't been here picture the movie, and they think it happens right down in the middle of town, but it doesn't. It happens up here, so it's a little more rural setting. Punxsutawney Phil is in a stump on Gobbler's Knob during Groundhog Day, and at about 7 o'clock in the morning, right before daybreak, the Inner Circle will make their traditional trek from up around here, around the visitor center, down through the crowd and onto the stage. And at that point, then we get into the kind of pomp and circumstance of the actual Groundhog Day ceremony. The way it all goes down here in Punxsutawney, the vice president of the Groundhog Club, he has to write two witty predictions that are typically related to something current going on, is the way it has been historically done. But he always has two predictions, a spring prediction and a winter prediction, walking into Groundhog Day. So we really don't know what's going to happen. Some people think it's probably scripted, but it really isn't. We have no idea. If you met our group as a whole, you would realize that we aren't the most prepared individuals. We definitely are a crew that flies by the seat of our pants. We're lucky enough to have an executive director who keeps us in line.
And you also all have day jobs.
That's right.
You are not professional inner circle groundhog handlers.
That's right. Okay. Yeah, we all have day jobs, so we're all volunteer. So anyway, the inner circle ends up on the stage on down by the stump on Gobbler's Knob, right around daybreak. The president will go to the stump. He has a acacia wood cane that has been handed down to him from president to president. And that cane gives him the ability to, and this is important, all of the way this is said is important, so everyone needs to understand, it gives him the ability to interpret groundhoggese, which is a language not spoken, but that the president can understand what Phil is purveying. So we will get Phil out of the stump after he is knocked on the stump three times with his cane, myself and the other handler. We pull him out, show him to the crowd, and set him on the stump. Phil will then communicate to the president in groundhoggese whether or not he's seen his shadow. The president will then take that message or his understanding of it and convey it to the vice president, who will read the corresponding scroll. That's how the prediction gets out to the public. And so really, in the end, we have nothing to do with it except for, you know, getting Phil to where he needs to be.
And this is the way it's been done for, what year is this? How many years?
That's the way it's been done in Punxsutawney for 134 years.
Mm-hmm. And so Groundhog Day, I believe I read on the website, has been celebrated since 1886 in mm-hmm. Punxsutawney, and sort of the Groundhog Club, you guys were founded in 1887, right?
Yeah. So it was kind of informal originally, and mm-hmm. we don't really know at what time those guys started getting together, but they were actually getting together to go groundhog hunting. Okay. And there was a point, well, right around 1886, the groundhog was first reported, I think 1885, to have been seen in Punxsutawney. It was reported in the local newspaper. The following year, those groundhog hunters, as the lore has kind of been spun, they found a groundhog out in the wild and they recognized him as unique. And it was at that point that Punxsutawney Phil, who wasn't Punxsutawney Phil yet, he wasn't named that yet, but that's when he went from being the main course to their companion. And they, you know, has been with us ever since. And as the Groundhog Club got more structured and as the lore, you know, kind of, you know, developed, he became Punxsutawney Phil. We started wearing top hats and tuxedos.
And what year was that about? Do you remember?
That was in the 50s, probably. Mm-hmm.
Why top hats and tuxedo? I mean, obviously it's a very important position to be in.
Well, it's not so much the position. So it's not for us. It's for Phil.
It's for Phil.
Because, you know, we as all his faithful followers recognize him as the king of all groundhogs and the only true weather prophet. So how better to honor him than the tuxedo and top hat? Okay.
So what does inner circle mean? And how many inner circle members are there?
Well, the inner circle is the board of, you know, per se, the board of directors of the Punxsutawney Groundhog Club. The Punxsutawney Groundhog Club is a club that anyone in the world can join. They pay an annual dues and then are privy to, you know, some inside information, advanced sales on tickets and things like that.
And there's chapters all over the country.
There are chapters. Yeah, you can actually form your own chapter of the Groundhog Club, and there are chapters all over the country. Some more active than others. Some amazingly active chapters. There's some people, obviously there's people in the world that are very into Groundhog Day, not just the 15 guys up here on Gobbler's Knob and the 5,000 people living in Punxsutawney.
All the people that join the Groundhog Club on groundhog.org have the ability to then be part of this members only reception. If you don't join the club, you can't go to this. Mm-hmm. But all you got, it's like $10 online. You can get into a place where there's, you know, they have foods, you know, or hors d'oeuvres for free, a little cash bar. Half of the inner circle members, or all the inner circle members, Phil's there for pictures. It's like a, you know, the gem of a place to be able to go. If you're coming to Punxy and want to get up close and tight with Phil and the inner circle, all you got to do is go online, groundhog.org, $10, you join the Groundhog Club. bada boom, bada bing, you got a private viewing, buddy. So,
how did you become a part of the inner circle?
And I'd always been around it. Mm-hmm. We'd always gone to it in high school. We came back from college with carloads of people from college. So it was just an awesome experience.
And that's still a thing that happens,
oh,
right?
People
from, Penn State track out here.
My day job is a chiropractor. I was in chiropractic school. My name was Pux. No one called me by my regular name because everybody knew about Groundhog Day and really enjoyed that. But the whole fact of, bringing everybody back and just enjoying what it is that we do. And myself, why I always thought I would want to do that, because I just thought, to get up on stage in front of thousands of people would just be what I would love to do. And I betray that in regular everyday life. So people see that in what mm-hmm. I do at you go out to have a few drinks or you go to a wedding and you go to a dance. I want to be the guy dancing with the center of attention. So, and people seeing that in the club that ran the stage show, they said, we need this guy, to get up there and ramp this crowd up. I probably mm-hmm. could do that. So that's how I got asked to be in as someone to take over the stage show eventually.
And so that was the role that you played. And then you got your name, Thunder Conductor. So I am going to comment on this and you can maybe say no comment, but you all are men.
We are all men.
So your director, your executive director of Groundhog Club is a woman.
She's the only paid.
But everybody else who's an inner circle member is a man. What's up with that?
Well, it's one of those things. There is no rule against a female being in the Groundhog Club. Mm-hmm. And I really don't doubt there will be someday. It just hasn't happened yet. Yeah.
Okay. So you all have interesting weather-related names. You're the Rainmaker. So do you choose, or is it like a nickname that people give you? Do you earn it?
The name is bestowed on you by the president when you're at a point after you're elected into the club. Sometimes it takes a while. Sometimes he has it immediately. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it's no relation. Sometimes you have no idea where they came up with the name. Mm-hmm. Sometimes there's myself and a couple other members that are actually had family in the club prior to us. So my name was actually handed down. My dad was in the club. He was the Rainmaker. And whenever I became a member, they gave me his name. So
who takes care of Phil the other 364 days out of the year that he is not doing this?
Well, that would be myself. And there's another handler, John Griffiths. We share the responsibilities. So every other day, one of us, I shouldn't say that, every day, one of us is at the zoo to feed Phil and Phyllis. Phyllis is Phil's wife who lives with Phil in the Groundhog Borough, which is down in our local library. But
and that's the zoo, essentially.
Call it the informally the zoo, but the formal name would be the Groundhog Phil's Borough.
Phil's Borough, yeah. At the library here in Punxsutawney, and that's where he lives with his wife.
Yeah, and it's just like if people haven't been there, it's like a natural kind of like an atrium. Maybe you might call it like a natural setting. It's climate controlled. It's got big glass windows on two sides. And
folks can go and see him when the library's open, or
you can see him from outside or inside.
Okay, mm-hmm. So you could come up to Punxsutawney at any point in time, and you could see Phil when he's not busy.
That's right.
Or making appearances because he makes a lot of appearances.
He does probably maybe 150 appearances a year. So we're out with Phil 150 different times for from everything from meeting a president of the United States of America, not Trump yet, but he did meet Reagan, and down to. Going to someone's birthday party, or who knows what he gets invited to. He goes to a lot of stuff.
Mm-hmm. Do you all have any prediction on how this year will go? So, do you even do illegal bets on the side as inner circle members? Like, this is going to be the year that he's going to see a shadow. He's not going to see a shadow, or no?
to be honest, I'm surprised there isn't a line on what his prediction will be. And maybe there is, and I haven't heard it yet, but... there are guys in the club that are team winter and there are guys in the club that are team spring. Team spring, across the world is obviously always more popular, but there are, people like myself who, I just love the winter. So I want a winter and I want a good winter.
With actual snow and not rain
like today. Yeah.
So what can someone expect if they were to travel to Punxsutawney for Groundhog Day? I personally have attended once. It was the most vibrant thing and also one of the most exhausting things I have ever done. But people could, in theory, listen to this podcast on Tuesday and decide, they're coming up. What can they expect?
Now, think of Groundhog Day. Think like New Year's Eve, you know? That's what the first...
That was kind of what it felt like. I mean...
Yeah, the first is the big day. like as far as what's going on in town. And it's like a lead up holiday. So, you know, everyone's getting fired up and there's lots of events happening, especially right before Groundhog Day. And then Groundhog Day happens. Well, most importantly, and this happens every year, you need to be here early, and you can vouch for this. You've been here.
Yeah.
You can't, like I say, yeah, Groundhog Day takes place at, you know, around 7 o'clock is when Phil comes out, 7 or 7:15, so wherever sunrise is. Well, don't think that you're going to pull into Punxsy at 6:30 and be present.
Here, yes.
Yeah. It takes time to get here. Once you get to Punxsutawney, it takes time to get on the knob and to find your place to stand and get situated and, you know, learn the lay of the land. It's the middle of the night in the woods. There's and it not, really is yeah, that.
You it know, really is. There's not that's, you know, the road that you're off of is not a big highway.
There's no road signs. There's no turnstile and rope gates directing you where to go. No, you're not getting very catered to. It's very, very organic experience.
Yeah. We stayed up. We stayed up overnight, essentially. Yeah. We came up and I think a lot of folks probably do that. You just kind of, so then you're here at standing at 4 a.m. or whatever time.
That's right.
It is.
Yeah. It's, you know, no matter whether it's the Groundhog Club making the trek down through the crowd and onto the stage, or it's somebody in Australia saying, hey, let's go to Groundhog Day and making the trek from there. And that, I mean, it is crazy. You walk through the crowd and one out of three people is from outside the country. It's amazing. And you'll say, well, what are you doing in the United States? And they're like, coming to Groundhog Day. Like, that's what we're here for.
They came,
you know, it always blows our mind.
They came to Punxsutawney from Australia.
Yeah, it always blows our mind because we don't, you know, we still don't, you know, it doesn't click like that, you know, that we, but that is, it is that big. And it's
how does the size of the town change? So you said 5,000 people-ish now. How big is it? How big will it be, I guess, on Sunday, February 2nd?
On a big year, so big year meaning weekend or a day bookending a weekend and good weather leading up to Groundhog Day, you're looking like 40,000 people up here on Gobbler's Knob. On a Wednesday in the rain, when it's been raining for 4 days prior, maybe 10 or 15,000. So it fluctuates that much. But I mean, even at 15,000 people up here, it's not like it feels empty. It's 15,000 is a crowd.
What's your favorite part? Like, what do you love about? So you love being on stage.
Love the whole night. I mean, the thing is, when you see it on TV, typically you see this guy, you know, AJ, you see Phil coming out of the stump, making his prediction. What many people don't see is what's happening before that. From 3 o'clock in the morning until 7, there's a show going on with singing and dancing, and we have
got to keep people moving. We have, it's middle of the night.
You know, the
cold.
Beagle Brothers. Yep, yep. You guys know the Beagles. They play four times during the night, four 10-minute skits. We have dueling pianos this year. We have another local band playing. We have a Gobbler's Knob Got Talent competition with happens the day before. So that's and then we got all that going on. We got the, you know, many other acts. We got Dan and I doing our thing, which is basically dancing around, making up words to songs that have to do with Groundhog Day, our parodies. We kind of love those, and the crowd seems to really, you know, take that.
So if someone can't make it on Groundhog Day, what are some other stuff? Well, and then I have one very important question about the elixir of life, but we'll get to that later.
Well, and this would lend itself to that. Uh-huh. So, you know, probably one of the most important things that we do as a Groundhog Club, other than Groundhog Day, is our summer picnic, which is the Groundhog Picnic. That is typically the weekend after Labor Day in September.
And that is open to the public.
It is open to the public. And it's, you know,
it's a lesser ceremony that people have no idea about, right?
Right.
Lots of people have heard of Groundhog Day. I was flabbergasted when we came up that this whole other thing exists.
And yeah. You were actually here for the picnic before you were here for Groundhog Day, correct?
Yes.
Yeah. So, you know, the picnic, and it's been going on as long as Groundhog Day in Punxsutawney.
Oh,
that picnic is, you know, when those guys were out hunting groundhogs back in the old days, that was the picnic they were hunting them at. So at that picnic, we, you know, it's basically the Groundhog Club or the Inner Circle's chance to kind of give back to the people that have helped them out throughout the year, as well as just a time to maybe invite people that might be considering coming to Punxsutawney on Groundhog Day. Well, they can come up when the weather's nice and maybe get a feel for it without diving in February when it's, you know, it's when you got to brave the cold and the crowds and everything else.
And so at this ceremony, Phil is given the elixir of life because Phil is 100 and...
Phil is at least 134 years old.
And he leads this long life because of the elixir of life.
He leads this long life. Yeah. Your typical groundhog lives from, you know, anywhere in the wild, maybe 8 to 10 years. Phil, on the other hand, like I said, he's at least 134. The reason for that is at our summer picnic, every year he gets groundhog a little taste of groundhog punch slash elixir of life. And with every sip of that, he gets 7 more years of longevity. So, you know, when it comes down to it, if you start doing the math, even if he did 2 sips a year, you know, it exponentially stacks up. He's got a lot of years ahead of him. And that recipe,
it's infinite.
It is. Yeah.
Right? I'm bad at math, but I'm pretty sure that if he drinks it every year,
he will be, he was around long before us and he'll be around long after. And
did it have an effect, do you think, like when it came out on the festivities up here?
It did, in a positive way, you know. Mm-hmm. But leading up to the movie, Groundhog Day was growing it had kind of gained some pretty good traction already. And then the movie guys came here, I think it was 91, to kind of case the mm-hmm. holiday and just get a feel for it. They already had it written, but they wanted to see what it actually was like for real. So they came up and then they did the movie. And after that, it really kind of blew up and got really big. It was, you know, it was amazing and awesome. I mean, what else could you ask for than for Hollywood to come in and make a movie about you?
With Bill Murray.
Right. I mean, like, it's pretty awesome. Pretty awesome.
You're Phil's handler. So what exactly does that mean? Obviously you take care of him.
Right. Yeah. I take care of him on a day-to-day basis. Mm-hmm. Feed him, make sure he's safe, make sure he's comfortable, take him to vet visits, take him to all his appearances.
How does he travel?
He travels, well, personally, he has a Phil carrier. Mm-hmm. It's like a Lexan tube,
so it's
with
big,
a base.
It's bigger than
it's
like
big. Like he can walk around in it. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it's clear. So you can get mm-hmm. pictures from all around it. It takes like 2 guys to kind of carry it. So he has that, but then that goes on to the Philmobile, which is we have like an airport shuttle bus mm-hmm. that we have, you know, decaled up. You know, Punxsutawney Groundhog Club, Inner Circle, Punxsutawney mm-hmm. Phil, you know, you see this bus going down the road, you know, he's coming. And actually, for Pittsburghers, you know, and I always say my favorite event that we do outside of Groundhog Day is actually the Pittsburgh St. Patrick's Day Parade, where we are, I believe, 4-time winners. Now, hold on to yourself because this is really exciting. 4-time runner up, senior, marching non-Irish men's division winners.
Just like putting words in
literally that is for real. Yeah. We've won that 4 times. Mm-hmm. We're very proud of that. Yeah. So we appreciate the parade committee and we love the St. Patty's Day Parade. We have a ball down there.
So that actually leads me to another question, which is, so Phil gets around. Mm-hmm. He's been to the White House. He's been on Oprah. He's been to New York City. When Phil comes to Pittsburgh, what is he, as his handler, do you know anything that he likes to do? Apparently, he makes a couple appearances a year down there.
We've been, for the last handful of years, we've been collaborating with Wiggle Whiskey and Threadbare and they do a whiskey with us and then a cider in Phil's honor. So they always invite us down once a year, usually, well, it's always in January. Mm-hmm. We were just there. Yeah, we were just there. They put us up in the William Penn, which Phil is always very appreciative of.
So Phil likes the William Penn. All
he
right.
likes to live a little high on the hog, you know. So.
And then, so what kind of training do you have to be Phil's handler?
Training to be Phil's handler mm-hmm. is literally trial by fire. The year that I became handler was, I became handler officially on Groundhog Day 2012, I believe it was. Might have been 2013. But the way it happened, the other handler that was retiring, I kind of shadowed him that year and we were done with, Phil was done for the day. It was about noon. We were in the park downtown, which the library is right beside. We were walking Phil back to his burrow to, you know, put him to give him a much needed nap. And that handler handed me his gloves and his keys to the zoo and said, well, here you go. And that's how you.
And that means you have to pick him up, and
that means
it.
You're so, gonna.
Yeah, you're literally handling him.
You're literally you're literally the handler now. So.
Have you been bit?
When you first become handler, you get bit a lot. As you get comfortable with Phil, and he learns to tolerate you, things you know kind of, like any other pet, he gets comfortable with you, and you know you guys can kind of get along.
So you guys have an understanding now.
Yes. Yes.
Like, what would you do, like, if you were going to come up here? So is there anything?
Okay, so
there's
diner. There's fantastic Phils, which are statues. We have 36 of them now, I think.
36 Phil statues. So you come up any day of the year, you can still see Phil in his burrow.
Still see outside. Phil in his burrow.
You can take your photo with 30 something statues, which would actually kind of be like a really great Instagram idea for anyone.
You could eat it in any number of places. I mean, you could eat at the signature Punxsy Phil's Cakes and Steaks, but the thing is, Punxsutawney has it. Not many towns have. We have a Serapine Alaska's pizza, which is a completely different pizza than you would get in many places, but it's a town favorite.
So what is it? Wait, explain it.
It's a little bit sweeter of a sauce. The cheeses are a little bit different. They're a little bit smaller in a sense where you're going to get one for yourself, but it's not a pan pizza, a personal pan pizza. It's a real pizza, but it's a thinner crust. It's not crispy. It's a perfect made pizza, in my opinion. Alaska's is something that everybody loves.
What's a bar we would go to?
The Borough Bar and Grill is our local favorite hangout spot. We got, you know, good owners. It's a little bit of a sports bar. And they have a wall of 12 taps with craft beer as well as regular beer. Okay. So it breeds to everyone.
And Phil has his own beer, right? Doesn't he? Or he used to?
I just saw a cooler stacked full of Punxsutawney Pilsner at the Borough.
Who brews Punxsutawney Pilsner?
Penn Brewing.
All right. Do we have any top secret pro tips that you want to tell folks if they are thinking of heading up either this year or next year? So obviously there's no hotels.
So book your rooms now.
Yeah. So if you think that this sounds fun.
If you're hearing this and you're thinking about going to Groundhog Day 2021,
book your
room now. Seriously. Mm-hmm. Call now. Get a great room. Bed and breakfast. Look there first. The only hotel in Punxsutawney is the Cobblestone. So it fills up relatively quickly. So there are some little gem bed and breakfasts in the area and close by that can also be utilized. And, you know, if you find that you already found booked, you know, Brookville's the next closest town over. You know, book the rooms now is the main thing.
So I make a list every year on the second or the third, when I get a chance, of things to remember the following year. And I told the club this year, the something I wrote down, and I've been in the club 10 or 11 years, whatever it is, and I'm still writing myself this note. I wrote this in my phone. No matter what you think, you do not own warm enough clothes, dress warmer. I am cold every year. People don't realize it 30, even if it's 40 degrees, 40 degrees in the day when the sun's out is totally different than 40 degrees in the middle of night when the wind's blowing and it's maybe raining, or if it's 25 and snowing or whatever. You have to dress warmer than you think. Like take like dressing for a Steelers game and double it because it's dark. It's cold.
And so pro tip,
wear dry clothes. Yeah. Dry clothes, warm clothes.
Yeah.
If you're dry and you're warm.
I think it rained the year we were here.
Yeah. If you're dry and you're warm, if you dress for it, you're going to have a ball. You're going to have an absolute ball, and you'll be like these people that have been coming here for more years than I ever have.
That's a pro tip.
That's a pro tip right there
of keeping a way to keep warm.
I mean,
once
you guys
are
outside the entire time. I mean, everybody is, but you're outside longer. So, all right. Well, I want to thank you both for joining us today. The club's website is groundhog.org, and it features lots more on the history and tradition of Groundhog Day, as well as a lot of more resources for visiting Punxsutawney. On Instagram, you're at PunxsyPhil, and on Facebook, it's PunxsyPhil.innercircle, or you could obviously just search Punxsutawney Phil, but you have to spell it right, and that's Punxsutawney.
Collaborations.
Hey, what's up, guys? This is Adam with Very Local. I'm coming at you with a collaboration, or a collab, as I like to say. So this one is actually, it's a food and beverage collab happening on the exact same street. So located at 3623 Butler Street is our beloved coffee shop, Espresso Amano. They do amazing coffee and espresso and lattes and all the good stuff, including some pastries and croissants and muffins and other stuff like that. Well, now for the first time, you can get Reed & Co. vegan snacks at Espresso Amano. So for folks unfamiliar, Reed & Co., that's R-E-E-D, located at 4113 Butler Street, just up the street from Espresso Amano, they do juice, and they do fresh cold-pressed juices, along with a selection of vegan snacks, including acai and pudding and oatmeal, and different like nut milks and things like that. So Reed, as he scales up and begins to find other places to sell his awesome snacks, is now working with Espresso Amano on a vegan snack program. You can pick up Reed & Co.'s different vegan snacks at Espresso Amano, located just to the right of the coffee bar. You'll see it in a big sort of a display case. So that's Espresso Amano on Butler Street. collaborating with Reed of Reed & Co., a juice and vegan snacks, located also on Butler Street, both in Lawrenceville, happening now. Check it out. Huge shout out to Espresso Amano and to Cam and the whole team there and Matt. And shout out to Reed at Reed & Co.
Events. Okay, so I'm giving you this one with a little bit of early notice for some Monday night plans because as of recording this, half the tickets are gone. And this is Golden Girls Trivia at 5801 in Shadyside. It's Monday, February 17th, 8 p.m. Does require a ticket, like I mentioned. $5 for individuals, $20 for teams of five. If you're an expert on all things Rose, Dorothy, Blanche, and Sophia, this one is for you. This might be the only trivia that I could personally even have a chance of completing. So, Golden Girls Trivia.
Well, I don't know what the weather's today. I think I might have heard tell of snow. But old Al Roker, you know, he's just a joker. What's a weatherman really know? You best be talking to a groundhog.
Talking to a groundhog.
Yeah, talking to a groundhog.
Talking to a groundhog.
You better ask a groundhog if we're gonna have the winter still. You best be talking to